Lamentations chapter number 2. Let's go to Lamentations 2. I'm not going to read the entire chapter per se, but we're going to take a few verses at a time and sort of give you an outline tonight. I don't know if you're accustomed to writing in your Bible, but get you a Bible where you can get accustomed to writing in it. If you get a Bible and you don't want to write in it, you really need to mark up your Bible, really. Get you a Bible where you can make notes, underline it, highlight it. And it's just like a carpenter, a brand new set of tools, but never uses it. I mean, it looks good, but if you don't ever use them, then it's a different story. So get you a Bible that you can mark up, okay? Chapter number 2, let's pray, and then we'll get to the study of the Word. Father, thank you, Lord, that we realize that the wonder of wonders is when God became flesh and dwelt among us. We thank you, Lord, that Jesus is the light of the world. We are to be the light of the world and salt of the earth. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that tonight that we would see a manifestation of your glory, and we see some hope, we see a manifestation of your holiness, and we see a manifestation of the power of your word tonight. We ask, dear God, that you'll help us. We pray that you'd have your hand upon America. We realize, Lord, that these are perilous times. We realize that. But, Lord, they can be profiting times. Also, Father, please help us. Help our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you look at chapter number 2, and we'll read verse number 5. Verse number 5 says, the Lord was as an enemy. Now, I'm going to tell you one thing, that you are not going to want Jesus to be your enemy. But here the Lord didn't say he was an enemy. He's not, because Israel is his people. But he was as an enemy. He had swallowed up Israel. He had swallowed up all her palaces. He had destroyed his strongholds and hath increased in the daughter of Judah mourning and, look at the word, lamentation. That word lamentations is only found one time in this book. It's found many other places in the Bible, but only one time in this book. The word means an expression of sorrow. It means cries of grief, the act of wailing or groaning. We know that Jeremiah is the author, isn't he? Jeremiah is the author, and this is not a happy book. If you're having a bad day, you want to get cheered up, you don't want to read this book. But on the other hand, all scripture is profitable. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now, if you want to read this book as an instruction in righteousness, that's a very good way to read this book. So we're going to see that this is not a happy book. It's not a book where you can get a lot of joy expressed. This is not a book of good news for his country. Chapter 2 has to do with the subject of rebellion. And rebellion is always lamentable. God is chastening his children, his own people. You believe God does that? Well, he said he does in Hebrews, right? God is chastening his people, and he chastens them in his hot displeasure. I believe that. Now, I believe that America has fallen under the chastening hand of God. I believe she's under the chastening hand of God right now. And listen, when a nation suffers, the people within that nation suffers. There are some innocent people. We think of little boys and little girls. And they have no idea what they're going to be facing if the Lord tarries his coming in 20 or 30 years. I mean, the way our nation is going now, if it keeps going the way it is going, our children's going to suffer. Our grandchildren's going to suffer. So we got to keep this in mind. Well, if we ever need to lift up America in prayer, it's now. And so this whole chapter deals with God dealing with his own people and his chastening hand upon them. Now, God has become as their enemy, and he fights against them. The old black preacher used to say, your arms are too short to box with God. And God's going to win every time. Amen. I'm going to look at four things concerning this. Let's break this chapter down in four things. First of all, we're going to see the lamentation of this prophet. We see that in verses 1 through 10. But look at verses 1 through 3. The prophet Jeremiah is going to grieve, or he's going to lament, that God has not pitied the people. Let's read it. Look at verse number 1. How hath the Lord covered the daughter of Zion with a cloud in his anger, and cast down from heaven unto the earth the beauty of Israel, and remember not his footstool in the day of his anger. You know what he said about heaven? He says, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. How many of you got a footstool at home? Anybody got a footstool? We got a few around here. But that's pretty comfortable, isn't it? Footstool's comfortable. May not be a whole lot to look at, but boy, when you need it, it's nice to have. And so he says, remember not his footstool in the day of his anger. Verse 2, the Lord hath swallowed up all the habitations of Jacob, his people, and hath not pitied. He hath thrown down in his wrath the strongholds of the daughter of Judah. He hath brought them down to the ground. He hath polluted the kingdom and princes thereof. He hath cut off in his fierce anger all the horn of Israel. Remember, the horn was used in various ways, or the trumpet, the horn. And it was used to call the assembling of the people. It was used to blow when they saw the enemy coming. But there was also four horns that was connected with the altar, wasn't it? And when a person wanted to be saved, all he had to do is grab the horns of that altar. God said that he had cut off the horn. In verse 3, he had cut off his fierce anger, all the horn of Israel. He had drawn back his right hand from before the enemy and burned against Jacob like a flaming fire which devoureth round about. Now, it is as if God did say, and by the way, he did. He just said, okay, I'm going to let you do what you want to do. I'm going to let the enemy have you. I'm taking my hand off of you. You know, if this country doesn't want God, God's a gentleman. He will oblige. He said, you don't want me. You want this. You want that. You want your own way. Have your way. Have it your own way. And so God is angry with his people. I believe he still is angry with those who turn their backs upon him. He laments that God has not pitied the people. In verses 4 through 7, Jeremiah is grieved. He laments that God has become as an enemy. We read verse 4 or verse 5, but look at verse 4. He hath bent his bow like an enemy. He stood with his right hand as an adversary and slew all that were pleasant to the eye in the tabernacle of the daughter of Zion. He poured out his fury like fire. The Lord was as an enemy. Twice he says this. Verse 4, verse 5. He hath swallowed up Israel. He hath swallowed up all her palaces. He hath destroyed his strongholds. Hath increased the daughter of Judah mourning and lamentation. Remember what the disciples said about the beautiful buildings? They said, look at all these buildings, Lord. And God says, there's not going to be one stone laid upon another. Nero came by and he took care of that, didn't he? He destroyed them. Destroyed them. And so be careful what you brag about. God can just take care of it just like that. Well, if you look at verse number 6, he hath violently taken away his tabernacle as if it were of a garden. He hath destroyed the places of assembly. The Lord hath caused the solemn feast and Sabbath to be forgotten in Zion, and hath despised in the indignation of his anger the king and the priest. Verse 7 says, the Lord hath cast off his altar. He hath abhorred his sanctuary. He hath given up into the hand of the enemy the walls of her palaces. They have made a noise in the house of the Lord as in the day of a solemn feast. So he laments that God has become an enemy to Israel. And then he laments that God has cast off his altar. In verses 8 through 10, let's look at that. The Lord hath purposed to destroy the wall of the daughters of Zion. You know what? Israel was proud of those walls. Those walls were meant for protection. Nehemiah had to rebuild those walls, didn't he? But they were proud of those walls. But the Lord has purposed to destroy the wall of the daughter of Zion. He has stretched out a line. What happens when the walls go down? The enemy comes in. You know what America has done? She done let her walls down. I'm telling you, from the north border, southern border, anybody can come into this country and do what they want. And so the Lord's purpose to destroy the wall of the daughter of Zion, he has stretched out a line. He hath not withdrawn his hand from destroying. Therefore, he made the rampart and the wall to lament. There's the word lament. They languished together. Her gates, they were proud of their gates too. Her gates are sunk into the ground. He hath destroyed and broken her bars. Her king and her princes are among the Gentiles. The law is no more. Now, Israel boasted about that law, didn't he? But God says, no more. You don't want me, you don't want my law. You don't want my ways, he says. Her prophets also find no vision from the Lord. You couldn't even hear from the prophets. And so God would destroy the altars, God would destroy the walls, God would destroy the gates, God would destroy or have nothing to do with the sanctuaries and the priests and the prophets. You know, there's a people, God said, that honors me with their lips. They do that every Sunday, don't they? But he says their heart is far from me. We're seeing that in America. Oh, we want God. We love God. We brag about God and country, and we have rallies of God and country, but I'm telling you what, anymore, they don't want God. You can't even get God's people in the house of God on a Sunday. And God says, okay, if that's the way you want it, yeah, that's the way you're going to get it. And so we have people like that. Listen, if God would destroy the physical places of worship, many who claim Christianity would not be affected. Are you listening? You hear what I said? If God would destroy the places. Now we have a place of worship. I thank God we do, don't you? I thank God we have a building that we can meet in. And pews that we can sit down, air conditioning. We ought not take that for granted. God gave us that. But if places like this would be destroyed, there are some professing Christians who would not be affected at all. They hardly, if ever, frequent the house of God. So it wouldn't destroy them. But you let their ball team not get to play. Have you ever seen a bunch of wild people as you saw yesterday on TV at these ball games? Man, it was like they've been caged up for a year. And man, all of a sudden they're let loose and they're hooping and hollering and carrying on. And you get somebody that shouts a little bit in the church and everybody looks at him like he's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, that's the truth. And so if God will destroy these physical places, many who claim Christianity would not be affected. Now, where are we? We were in verse number 10. The elders of the daughters of Zion sit upon the ground and keep silence. They have cast up dust. They have cast up dust upon their heads. They have girded themselves with sackcloth. The virgins of Jerusalem hang down their heads to the ground. So he laments that God has cast off the altar. I'm glad we have a place to worship. I really am. But if this place would be destroyed, that would not affect my worship. The only way it would affect my worship is I would not get to worship with you like we can do collectively here in the house of God. I'm glad we can meet together. I'm glad we can worship together. And I'm glad for this place. I really am. But if this place would be destroyed, that should not affect your worship. By the way, Sunday's not the only time of worship. You ought to start in the morning, getting up, thank God. We give you a good night's sleep, if you got a good night's sleep, right, Cliff? But thank God anyway. So we have the lamentation of the prophet. Now, in verses 11 through 16, we're going to look at the laughter of the enemy. The laughter of the enemy. Verse number 11 tells us about, he says, "Mine eyes do fail with tears. My bowels are troubled. My liver is poured upon the earth for the destruction of the daughter of my people, because the children," now look, "and the sucklings," those little ones, "swoon in the streets of the city." Those children, those little babies, going to be affected. And America is being affected today like that. The lamentation of the laughter of the people because of the false prophets. Look at verse 12, 13, and 14. The false prophets, they say to their mothers, "Where is corn and wine?" When they swooned as the wounded in the streets of the city, when their soul was poured out into their mother's bosom, "What thing shall I take to witness for thee? What thing shall I liken to thee, O daughter of Jerusalem? Or what shall I equal to thee that I may comfort thee, O virgin daughter of Zion? For thy breach is great like the sea. Who can heal thee?" Look at verse 14. "Thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee, and they have not discovered thine iniquities to turn away thy captivity, but have seen for thee false burdens and causes of banishment." The laughter of the enemy because of the false prophets. You know, we got, whether you realize this or not, America is full of false prophets. Yes, yeah. They're full of false prophets. We got people telling you that you just name it and claim it, everything will be okay. It's not going to be okay. God says there's a thing that America's got to do, and churches have to do, and Christians individual have to do. That's repent. God's not going to bless if we don't repent. God's not going to bless our nation if we don't repent. God is not going to bless our churches if they don't repent. And so we got a lot of, when's the last time you heard Joel Osteen preach on repentance? I've never heard that guy preach on repentance. All he does is smile and let his teeth reflect the glowing light. Tells how you can make it in this world. Flips back his hair. I know, I'm jealous, I know. But anyway. The laughter of the enemy. America has enemies and they're laughing at us. The church has enemies. And they're laughing at us. They're laughing at us. Well, because of the false prophets, they laugh because the joy has departed. Look at verse 15. Verse 15. All that, and I mentioned this morning, I think. "All that pass by clap their hands at thee. They hiss and wag their head at the daughter of Jerusalem, saying, Is this the city that men call the perfection of beauty, the joy of the whole earth?" Are you sure you got that description right? Is this the city that we've been hearing about? This is supposed to be a joyful city. This is supposed to be a great city. And look at it. The world is laughing. The enemy's laughing at Jerusalem. They're laughing at God. They're laughing at people that claim Jesus as their Savior. My friends, look, there is a testimony that we have to maintain, even in the midst of all this wickedness that's going on in our country. We've got to maintain a wickedness. We can't be down in the dumps all the time. Now, look, it's easy to get down in the dumps when you watch that crazy TV. Yeah. See what's going on. It's easy. It's easy to get down in the dumps when you don't even recognize the country in which we live in. It's easy. But Jesus said that we would have tribulation. Remember this morning, be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. Well, if we could just get a glimpse of heaven at that moment, if we just get a glimpse of glory and realize this world's not my home, I'm just passing through. My home's way, way, way beyond the blue. I'm going up to be with the Lord one day. That's the only thing I got to look forward to, don't you? Well, the enemy, they're laughing because of the false prophets and because the joy has departed. By the way, you know Israel was a people that liked to sing? You realize that? Look at Psalm 137 real quick. Psalm 137. When Israel was in captivity, Babylon, Psalm 137. Verse number 1. Psalm 137, verse number 1. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept. We wept when we remember Zion. Some of you that have a little bit of age on you, remember when our country was something very, very, to be very, very proud of. When men were men, women were women, when soldiers fought to win the war. But now we're afraid to offend anybody. Everybody's got to get a trophy now. Look, I'm just telling you, we have changed. And it's not been for the better. You say, preacher, what's happened? I told you this morning, invasion. We've had an invasion. Well, look at verse 2. We hanged our harps up on the willows. I wonder why they call it a weeping willow. We hanged our harps up on the willows in the midst thereof. For there, they that carried us away captive required of us a song. And they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Now they were picking on Israel, weren't they? They were poking fun at them. And then here's what they said, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? I feel that way about America. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesties among the fruit, above the fruited plains, America. Man, I'm just telling you, when we sing that song, it ought to break our hearts to see where we've gone. America is in trouble. The laughter of the enemy. Look at verses 17 through 19. Let's go back to Lamentations now. Look at 17 through 19. In verses 17 through 19, we see the long suffering of the Lord. Have you ever wondered why Jesus hadn't come back yet? Boy, I have. Every day I look for him. Every day I get up in the morning and say, well, Lord, you didn't come last night. Maybe it'll be today. Some of you have a pen, lapel pen, that says perhaps today. I think whose ministry was that? Used to memorize scripture all the time. Oh, you know who I'm talking about. Yeah, Van Impe. Van Impe used to put out that little lapel pin, perhaps today, and he talked about perhaps Jesus will come today. And he may come today. He may come before this hour is over. But every day I look for him to come. The long suffering of the Lord. Verse 17. The Lord hath done that which he hath devised. Now watch this. He hath fulfilled his word that he had commanded in the days of old. He fulfilled his word. Israel had not fulfilled theirs. He hath thrown down, hath not pitied. He hath caused thine enemy to rejoice over thee. He hath set up the horn of thine adversaries. Verse 18, we see the plea of the people. Verse 18, their heart cried unto the Lord, O wall of the daughter of Zion. We've heard so much about that wall this time, haven't we? O wall of the daughter of Zion, let tears run down like a river day and night. Give thyself no rest. Let not the apple of thine eye cease. We've heard much about the wall. Look, let me just go a few pages back, a few books back to Psalm 62. Let's look at that wall for just a second. I won't run very far after this rabbit. We'll get back. Psalm 62. Look at verse number 3. Psalm 62 and 3. How long will ye imagine mischief against a man? Ye shall be slain, all of you, as a Bowing wall shall ye be, and a tottering fence. As a bowing wall. That wall is about to collapse. Israel's proud of that wall, but that wall is about to collapse. Isaiah 59 and verse number 10. Let me read that for you. Isaiah 59:10. The Bible says we grope for the wall like the blind. That wall was a means of protection. I already said that. But they said we grope for the wall like the blind, and we grope as if we had no eyes. We stumble at noonday as in the night. We are in desolate places as dead men. So that wall, and then the apple of thine eye, four times, God said that Israel was the apple of his eye. That's a good statement, isn't it? Four times. Well, the long suffering of the Lord, he warned the people previously. The people would plead and cry out to God. And verse number 19 was the plan for the people. He said, arise, cry out in the night. In the beginning of the watches, pour out thine heart like water before the face of the Lord. Lift up thy hands toward him for the life of thy young children. Look, if you don't care anything about yourself and your country, you at least ought to care about your children and what they're growing up in. Look what he said again. Verse number 19, lift up thy hands toward him for the life of thy young children that faint for hunger in the top of every street. Well, the plan for the people was to cry out, to repent. And then lastly, we see the law of sowing and reaping. Now, the prophet, we saw him in Lamentation. We saw the lamentation of the prophet. We saw the enemy laughing. We saw Jesus, the Lord, God being long-suffering, and he still is, isn't he? But then the law of sowing and reaping. If you're going to sow, guess what? You're going to reap. Look at verse 20. Behold, O Lord, and consider to whom thou hast done this. Shall the women eat their fruit and children of a span long? Shall the priest and the prophet be slain in the sanctuary of the Lord? Well, first of all, we see the sin of the people is obnoxious. Look, what did you catch that? What that said in verse number 20, the first part of that? Behold, O Lord, and consider to whom thou hast done this. Shall the women eat their fruit? He's not talking about vegetables. He's talking about their babies. You see that? The fruit of the womb. Shall the women eat their fruit and children of a span long? Now I don't know how even to describe that. But he said that's because of Israel's sin that they're doing this. He said, could that ever happen to America? America is already obnoxious in some of its ways. It really is. I tell you what, I'm glad that I live in a country. I'm glad I don't live in a city where you see more of this stuff that's happening every day. The young and the old lie, verse 20, shall the women eat their fruit, their children of a span long? And then the sanctuary of the Lord is no refuge. It seemed like you can't even go to church and find the answer anymore. The last part of verse number 20, shall the priest and the prophet be slain in the sanctuary of the Lord? Well, if there's any place you ought to find an answer, you ought to be able to go to the house of God. But you can't find answers in the house of God anymore. Why? Because the word of God is not prevalent in the house of God. We got to do everything in this world except preach this book. This book is the answer. This book is the answer. This book gives you the answer. And if we're going to be playing church, we're not going to get the answer. And so he says here that the sanctuary of the Lord is no refuge. You can't even find refuge in the house of God here. And then lastly, the sword of the enemies brings death. I want to show you something. Verse number 21. The young and the old lie on the ground in the streets. My virgins and my young men are fallen by the sword. Thou hast slain them in the day of thine anger. Thou hast killed and not pitied. Thou hast called as in a solemn day my terrors round about. So that in the day of the Lord's anger none escaped nor remained. Those that I have swaddled and brought up hath mine enemy consumed. The sword of the enemy brings death. Now, the only way to get America back, the only way to get Israel back, was to repent. You believe that? I mean, we can try new governments. We can try new programs. We can try different administrations. That's not going to do it. If America doesn't repent, she is going to end up like the last verse of the last chapter in Lamentations. Let's turn there. Chapter 5, the very last verse. You'd think with all this going on that Israel is going to repent. Surely they're going to repent. Look at verse number 19, or verse 16. The crown is fallen from our head. Boy, we used to be looked upon as the greatest nation on the face of this earth. The crown is fallen from our head. Woe unto us that we have sinned. Boy, if we would do that from the White House on down to the church house. We have sinned. For this our heart is faint. For these things our eyes are dim. We don't have the right kind of vision. Because of the mountain of Zion, which is desolate, the foxes walk upon it. Thou, O Lord, remainest forever, thy throne from generation to generation. That's the only thing that's going to be remaining. Wherefore dost thou forget us forever and forsake us for a long time? Turn thou unto thee, O Lord, and we shall be turned. Or turn thou us unto thee, O Lord, and we shall be turned. Renew our days as of old. What's the very first word, chapter, or verse number 22? But. You ever try to explain something to somebody or tell them a solution and they'll say, but. Here's what they said. But thou hast utterly rejected us. Thou art very wroth against us. What a sad way to end this chapter. What a sad way for America to end. Well, if we don't repent, that's exactly going to be our end. But before that happens, I firmly believe that Jesus is going to come and take us on home. Now, he may let us, I'm not saying the church is going through the tribulation, God forbid. We're not going to do that. But he may let us get down to this point where we're just going to beg and plead and cry out to God, please, Jesus, come. We're not going to worry about who's playing ball the next week. We're not going to worry about the next car we're going to buy. We're not going to worry about moving into a new house. All that we're going to think about is, Jesus, you need to come. Take us on home. It's going to get that bad, ladies and gentlemen, if we're not careful. If we don't repent and get right with God, it could get that bad. I don't want it to get that bad. Do you? I don't want to see my children and my grandchildren suffer. I don't want to see that. But America's got to repent. That's the answer. Father, have mercy upon us. Please help us. God, we see our nation going downhill. And Lord, I really can't look at this chapter and say, boy, what a lot of good news we have there. We have to look at you and your people and how your people had turned their back upon you. And you became as their enemy. A lot of things happened, Lord, that we have not experienced yet, but could experience. So, Father, we pray that you'd have mercy upon us, upon our churches, upon our country. We ask, dear God, that we would just pray along with John, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Father, would you do that tonight? Help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.